Thanks for coming back and joining me for another training lesson in Microvellum Toolbox. Now in this one, I'm going to do my best to try to teach you about formulas. Now I'm no expert when it comes to formulas or Excel for that matter, but I was able to get some things done in Toolbox with some library customizations, which does require knowing something about working with these formulas. So I'll do my best in this one and show you a few things and a couple tips and tricks along the way. Let's get started. Now when working in Toolbox, you'll notice a lot of formulas inside of these products. Now these formulas are basically like math equations, and to really take your skills to the next level, understanding how to read and write formulas is going to be key to doing that. So I have the spreadsheet and just a couple simple math equations that are showing here, and I think, or I hope at least, that this is going to help you understand how to read some of these formulas inside of Microvellum. So 1 plus 1, right? 1 plus 1 equals 2. Simple. Now notice this formula is the structure of it, just a simple math equation. The next one down, in this situation, what we would do is we would add up what's inside of the parentheses first, and then we would say 1 plus 1 plus 2 equals 4. And then so on and so forth. 2 times 2, 4 divided by 2. We would work this one out, 4 times 2 equals 8. I'm sure this is pretty remedial for everybody, but by going through this, we're gonna get into some of these if statements, and now we'll see how the structure is similar to those basic equations. Now this is an if statement. So the way this if statement works, we're looking into 1 plus 1 equals 2 first before doing anything. So that's considered the logical test. Is that true? And if it is, then it'll go to this value. And if it's false, then that would be the answer. Now this row is a little bit different, and you're gonna see a lot of this in Toolbox as well, where we have an if and statement. So if something were to be true or false, return a result. But if more than one thing happens to be true or false, then it would give us that result. So the way to read that is if 1 plus 1 equals 2 and 2 plus 2 equals 4, then give me yes, otherwise give me no. Now the next one you'll see, it's returning the no value because both of these need to be true for it to work properly. So if one of them is true and the other one's not, that's why we're now getting this. The way to work around that is by using an if or statement. So now only one of these needs to be true. If 1 plus 1 equals 2, or 2 plus 2 equals 20, return yes. This one, because neither one of these are true, the result is no. Now, one thing to make a note of here is that there needs to be the same amount of open parentheses as there are closed. So we have 2 open and 2 closed. Now, the placement depends on the functions that are being used. Now, when I say function, that's referring to this if part of the formula, or the or, and is also a function. Basically, when you see a word with all caps before an open parentheses, it's a function. Now that's gonna make a little bit more sense as we get into our formula editor and we highlight some of those functions to see how it's working. But we'll get there in a few minutes. So again, just reviewing some more if statements here. If the height is 30, then something will turn on. If it's not, then something will turn off. A 1 means that it's on, and a 0 means that it's off. So when you see these symbols, pretty sure we all know what those are. The next one over, not equal to, and then these two, equal or greater than, and equal or less than. Now let's talk about this one for a second. So when you want Toolbox to look for text and not a defined name, we use the quotation marks before and after the text. Defined names have no space between the words or underscores in lieu of those spaces. Okay, now for the next step in this video, we're gonna get into a product and we're gonna create a new prompt with a formula-driven value. That prompt name, we're gonna call it test data. Okay, so I'm inside of a new project and I just have this base 2-door drawn. Let's go ahead and get one drawn in your project. And once you do that, we're gonna open it up and edit design data. Make sure we're inside of our local workbook and select the prompts tab. Now scrolling down, not all the way to the bottom, we don't have to go all the way down. Let's go find our product price adjustment. So at line 249, select that entire row and right click and insert a new prompt. Now make sure we insert a new prompt so it doesn't mess up any of those defined names below. And now we have the cell that's ready to accept the new prompt name. We're just gonna call this one test data. We're not adding any underscores here. Just type it out however you want. There could be a space or no space. If there is a space, the underscore will be added automatically once we define that name. So just tabbing over to the next cell, and this is gonna be our value. Now we wanted to make this a formula-driven value. First, hit F2 to open up our formula editor box. I think that's what it's called. Either way, open up this thing here. So now we can start typing in that equal sign. All these formulas always start off with an equals. And we're just gonna go with something really simple. If width which is a defined name inside of this product, equals, we'll just say 30, comma. So that's that logical test. Now, if it was true, I want it to give me a 1. Otherwise, give me 0. And close parentheses. Now, always hit apply formula. And now we have that red showing up inside of our value cell. So that means it's formula driven. You can see up here, there's our formula. So currently, it's giving us a 0 because the width does not equal 30. So you can see how that formula works, but we're not done with our prompt yet before we move on to the next step. So now that we're here, we want to make sure that we right-click in this value cell and define that name. Now we could have done that before adding that formula. It doesn't really matter the order that you do it in. Just make sure that we define the name so Toolbox knows it's in there and we don't get a name error. Now we're not going to add anything else under these columns here yet. You can see up at the top what those columns are used for. But instead of doing it here, we're going to go to part properties. There is one last thing before we do that. I want to scroll over to this column here called our tab index. Now, as I select this value right above our new prompt, hit F2, it has this formula here, which is basically looking for the tab name and then giving us a number. So once it finds rendering options in this situation, it's going to look to column N and then it's going to count down how many. So that formula works basically where it looked for rendering options. It was in row 17 minus 1, and that's why it gives us a 16. You don't have to worry about understanding that too much right now. That's probably getting into the weeds a little bit. The main thing is that we drag that down to this one, and now it's under the 16th tab. But because I don't want that, I'd rather have it coming in the very first tab. We're just going to highlight that and replace rendering options with main. Now make sure it's spelled how I have it here so it matches how it's also inside of that tab list, which is column N. Okay, hit apply formula. If it worked, then that should return a 0. Now we can save and close out of this and go into part properties. Now inside of part properties, selecting on the prompts tab, scrolling pretty far down on the list here, and there's our test data prompt. Now the reason I wanted to go through part properties is because under the control type, we have the pull down list, which tells you what the control type actually is. So in edit design data, you have to put in the number, and we don't know that number unless we've gone into part properties first to see what that is. So a dimmed text box is the control type we want, and you can see that number is 10. Selecting on the other ones will return that number, text box 1, radio button 2, the next one is a 3. You can also find all this inside of our Microvellum knowledge base. There's some documentation giving you a list of what number these control types are, but just wanted to show you can go into part properties and you have this option for a drop-down list. We're not going to worry about any of these. Hidden, that would be one that you might want if you don't want it to show up on your prompts page, but you can also hide that by selecting a hidden control type. So either one, they're basically the same thing. Hide on reports is something different. Self-explanatory, not going to show up on a report. And then the color, we'll just change the color to blue. Now we're going to save and close out of this and open up our prompts page and see what this looks like. Okay, so currently test data is inside of that main tab and it has a 0 because our width is 36. So let's change that to 30. You can right click and hit refresh. You can also go to the menu tab and refresh that way. But you'll notice there our test data now has a value of 1. Okay, let's go back into edit design data again. Find our test data prompt, select F2, and now instead of it being equals, we're going to say if it's greater than 30. And instead of it returning a 1, we want it now to return some text. So like I mentioned earlier, if there's anything that's text, it needs to be inside of these quotation marks. So that's what we get if it's greater than 30. And if it's less than 30, we don't like that. So hit apply formula, and now you can see how that works. Now scrolling up to the very top, you can actually just come into this value here, which is the same thing on our prompts page, just in the spreadsheet format. But because that's not red, it's not formula driven, we don't have any issues just changing it right inside of our cell. So now instead of it being 36, it's 30. And notice that test data doesn't like that. So because it's not greater than 30, it's returning the second value. All right, so now let's see what happens if it's less than 30. It still doesn't like that. What if it's less than or equal to 30? There you go. See, it changed. So you can play around with that. You can kind of see how it works given those different scenarios, less than, equal to. This one would be if it's not equal to 30. Just hit enter after you've changed that formula. So I don't know about you, but working with formulas got me pretty excited the first time I actually got one to work the right way. Hopefully this will help you out and gets you to that next level in working with your products. All right, so that brings us to a good stopping point. We'll call this one done for now and we'll pick it back up in our next video. So until next time, keep practicing and we'll meet back here for some more training.